make it, why a B6 vehicle might be suitable. There's a greater argument as to having an independently certified vehicle that is certified to international standards, whatever those standards that there are. There is a number of them, and that's a debatable issue as well. So this particular session, very pleased Piet Jan can share with us. There's a bit of black magic about all the standards and the processes and certifying it, and particularly now coming into the edition 3 with the blast certification changes from the previous ERV standards. So we're very pleased to have you. We're very much looking forward to your presentation. And again, at the end, there'll be plenty of time for questions. And then at the end of the day, too, the very last session will be that of a industry discussion, so we can have a more frank and fearless conversation about the issues then too. Thanks so much.
Okay, thank you very much, Rob, for the kind introduction. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure for me to stay here in front of you and to brief you a bit on, well, the standards being used to those armored vehicles. And here you see a nice picture made in our test facility from TNO, based in the Netherlands, where we tested this vehicle. You see the weapon and the vehicle on a platform in order to rotate and tilt the vehicle in certain shot line angles. That's part of the standard. So as mentioned, my name, Piet-Jan Leerdam. You can also call me Piet if that's easier. Working for TNO already quite a long time. And from day one, I was involved in the protection and the survivability of vehicles, started in the military domain. And in the last years, also the civilian armored vehicles are part of our business. So the outline of my presentation. There it is. I will start with a short introduction, then brief you a bit on the test standards. But I also want to focus a bit on the protection requirements. We already heard a bit in the previous speech. And then, of course, I will go a bit more into detail about the VPM standard, both for the ballistic part as well as for the blast protection part. And then I also want to share with you the use of the mannequin, in this case the anthropomorphic test device, the crash test dummy, some background information. And then it finished with, the certification and report, what is really important to write down after a test campaign. And I will finish my speech with a brief summary and a kind of final remark. On the other hand, it's also a kind of teaser. So, to start with my speech, and then I think I have to say, armoring a vehicle is really an expertise, and I'm glad to see several of those experts in this room. And next to that, also testing a vehicle is an expertise. And also, for that part, several people are sitting here in this room, and of course, I'm one of the experts as well. But it also, and that's really important, it starts in the procurement phase, and also for there, you need to have an expert to define or to come up with the procurement requirements, and specifying those requirements is another expertise. And I think also with the speech from Alex, we heard a bit about it. The need for having civilian armored vehicles, I think it's still there. We are all aware of the problems in the world. So there is a big need. And you see there's a growing need of having well-tested and well-certified vehicles. And therefore, you need those test standards, which give you the procedures to test the vehicle in a proper way and at the end to come up with a clear certification document. The focus is all to the occupant safety. So it's not about the vehicle itself, it's about surviving of the crew or the passengers inside the vehicle. And then you can raise the question, what is then acceptable in terms of risk of injury? And also in the previous speech, we heard a bit about it. It's really important to realize, what do we accept? On the other hand, a capability like mobility is also important. It helps to survive, to get away from the attack scenario, the place of incident. And that helps to have the people safe as well. And there should be a kind of balance. And you can talk about the golden triangle. It's a balance between the level of protection, between having the mobility, and between, well, what's left, the payload. And that's all restricted by the weight of the vehicle, the volume restrictions of the vehicle, but also the mobility aspects. And I think we also hear about it in the speech from TSS. So it's really important to realize. So we can go very high with the protection level, but when your vehicle is too heavy and can't drive anymore, then you don't have a good solution. So when it comes to the standards, there are several standards in the world, and I'm talking about vehicle standards. And we have the vehicle standards in the military domain, the Stanag 4569, with the volume 1 of the Allied Engineering Publication number 55 for the ballistic part, and we have the volume 2 and 3 for the blast, the mine and IED part. Then we have the category of the up-armored vehicles, the SUV type of vehicles, and there we have several standards applicable. It's the VPEM standard, with the BRV for the ballistic part and the ERV for the blast part. In the UK, we know about the PAS 300, and last year in the same conference, we got a speech also from Mark French together with Dr. Roger Shaver about the PAS. And then still also the Stanag can be used, and you see that those type of vehicles are also used by the military, for example, the military police. And that means that sometimes they also required to have such a vehicle being tested according to the Stanag. For the ballistic part, the volume 1 is not really applicable. It can be done, but it's quite complex. But nevertheless, for the blast part, you have the volume 2 and 3, which are applicable for those category of vehicles. And then we have another category, has more the armored VIP cars. And there we still have the VPEM standard and the PAS standard. And there you don't see the use of the Stanag standard. So the Stanag 4569, it's well known in the military domain worldwide and being used officially by the NATO countries. But you see it also being used in other countries, at least also by the vehicle producers, and it can be tested by an experienced test institute, and they can come up with a test report and a certificate according to the Stanag. Then the VPAM, BRV, and ERV, in the meantime also quite well known. From origin, it was a German standard from the VPAM Association, and officially certifying is limited to VPAM members. Nevertheless, test institutes can use the standard to test a vehicle accordingly. And then the PAS 300, a more UK national standard, in the meantime also quite known. And also there, any test institute with some experience in that field and experience with the PAS can do the job. So then what about some other standards? Then I'm talking about the EN 1063 or the EN 552 or the NIJ. Well, those standards are there being used, but those standards are not vehicle test standards. Those standards are for testing the material. So like the glass sample or like a door section. So it does not cover the complete vehicle. Of course, it can be or can give you a start. But it's not testing the complete vehicle like we are doing with a vehicle test standard. So the whole game or the whole process starts with the requirements. And also a bit copied from the military domain, we can talk in several levels. That starts with the operational level. And also there, the previous speech from Alex is an excellent example where it should start. With the threat specification, because the end user is operating in certain areas and they have to think about the operational requirements. Where, which threat, which task, what are the risks, what is being accepted. And with that information, you can go to the functional requirements. So the procurement manager or fleet manager can think about, what are then the specific functional needs that I need to have in my mission area. So which level of protection? What is the task of my vehicle? And we already heard about different tasks in the same area. And then when you go further, zoom in, then we come to the technical requirements. And that can be for the vehicle protection supplier, developing the protection of the vehicle according to several requirements related to the functional and operational requirements. And on the other hand, we need some technical requirements when it comes to testing of the vehicles. So the operational requirements, it's about the area of operation, which location, is it peacekeeping, is it the war zone area, what are the terrain conditions, then of course, really important, the threat. So which threat do we face in terms of the ballistic threats, the blast threats, well, also addressed by Alex in the speech before. Or are there even other threats, like anti-tank weapons, or what we heard about, really large threats, the overmatch threats. And then when it comes to the occupant safety, also there we have to think about, when we talk about acceptance, the risk of getting injured, or the severity of the injuries, what is important, and which threats do we see when it comes to the occupant itself, in terms of fragments or the biomechanical loads. So zooming then in into the functional requirements, we have to define the protection level on a functional level. Then in general, the ballistic protection is mandatory. You want to have the ballistic protection, and you've seen a small arm threat is still an important one. Then you can think about, is there a need for blast protection? Do I need to have a vehicle being protected against the hand grenades, the AP mines, or even a side blast? So is it optional or is it also mandatory and part of the complete protection package of your vehicle? In general, that are the primary requirements. And then you can think about secondary requirements when it's related to mobility or safety. Do I need to protect my engine compartment or the battery or some other critical components? Do I need to include some extra safety measures like security locks, like emergency hatches, etc.? Is there a need for in certain missions? And then finally, the technical requirements. How to build? Several experts are here in this room and they can better explain what's needed in terms of the requirements to build a vehicle, which sides of the vehicle to be protected, what type of materials do we use, how to integrate, how to draw it, how to refer to it in kind of drawing package or numbering, and finally also to do something with production quality control. And tomorrow, Dr. Roger Schaefer will say some words about that part. And for testing the vehicles, we need to have the experience, but also the test standards, the specifications, the threats for testing, and the threat for testing could be a different one than the threat in theater. We have to realize. Of course, it should be close. It should be more or less give the similar response as what we see in reality, but it could be different. Then about, the location of the threats, the angles, shooting angles, how to instrument the vehicle, which criteria do we use, and how to report, and at the end come up with a certification document. So that brings me then to the VPM standard, and to share with you some details of the VPM standard. The VPM from origin, it's an, German-Swiss association, but also, we as TNO are full member here in the Netherlands. From Austria, there's a member from France. And the main goal of this association was to define test procedures, and not only for vehicles, but also, for example, for the personal protective equipment, like helmets and vests, but to define the test procedures for standard testing and also to share the experience that we all learn from each other and test the products or the vehicles in this case in the same way, with the same methods, in order also to get the same results at the end. So the VPM has then several standards. Two of them are for vehicle testing, and that is the BRV, the ballistic resistance vehicle, or the ERV, the explosive resistance vehicle. Maybe I skipped it, the VPM, it's from Rich and the German organization. more or less European nowadays. It was chaired by a German chairman, but since August this year, or July this year, the chairmanship was taken over by Tino, and Mr. Tim Renes, he's sitting here in the middle of the room, is now the chairman, and starting with, well, contacting everyone, do a kind of introduction tour, and that hopefully is then, well, the start for Tim to follow up as chairman on the VPM and also to, well, continue the job together. Back to the BRV and ERV. On the website, it's publicated what the latest versions are. And for the BRV, it's a VPM BRV edition 3. For the ERV, we have there the VPM ERV 2010 edition 2, since 2017. The existing one, and next to that we have the VPAM ERV edition 3 since 2021. And there's also written that's being used on customer request. The ERV standard, it's not really published on the website, but you can apply for getting a copy of that via the chairman of the secretary of the VPAM. And I really want to say that testing or doing a certification job, it's not just testing, it's a whole process. And at the end, it's about getting confidence in the protection concept of your vehicle. And that's the reason that we do this job and do so many shots and so many tests, to build up that confidence that what the supplier is delivering is really what I want to have as an end user and give the protection according to the specifications. So again, it's a process. So let's start with the ballistic part. Well, as mentioned, it's a process. So what's the approach? It all starts with having a test plan where it's written what is the protection level, how is the vehicle being protected, meaning what are the main areas or the main protection concepts integrated in that vehicle, because I need to pre-test those areas in what we call the VPM PM testing. So the PM part with the PM procedure is part of the VPM. It's not a vehicle standard, but it's a material test standard. So we start with shooting on main area samples with a certain procedure. And you see here on the top picture, 6 shot on an armored concept with a large triangle and a small triangle. For the glass, we only use the large triangle and with the introduction of the new BRV, we not only test the flat samples, the flat glass samples, but also the banded glass samples, because we know that in the production process, a banded glass sample is much more complicated than a flat glass sample or flat glass box. When that's being okay, and those solutions give the proper protection, and then we switch over to the BRV testing, meaning we are testing the complete vehicle with the built-in protection concept. We start with the vehicle inspection to check the built-in protection concept and to see where are the weaknesses in the concept. So that's a kind of preparation for the test institute. We start testing the vehicle, and then of course it could happen that you have a kind of failure. And a failure means that we have to retest such a location when it's being improved. And that can be done on a complete vehicle, but you can also do that on a mock-up. For example, you see here the rear end section of a Toyota Land Cruiser, which was then retested next to the previous test campaign on the full-scale vehicle. Or you see also a sample of a roof hatch, which was a new design for the roof section, and retested again. So it was also mentioned by Rob, when you modify a vehicle, you need to be sure that the certification is still valid and applicable for that vehicle. So when there's a design change or an extra feature like a roof hatch, it needs to be retested. So in the process, and also quite important, you have to make some choices or some selections. It's not only the threat level, of course. You also need to realize that we protect the vehicle all around, so in azimuth, 360 degrees. And then we have the elevation angle, so the shooting line from the weapon to your vehicle. And in the VBEM standard, the standard is 90 degrees, so really from the top, but you are allowed to specify a lower angle, so going to 45 or 30 degrees, or when needed, even something else, but it needs to really specify it. And why is that included? Well, you can think again about reality. Is it really, really realistic that you're being shot at from the top in a straight line, or is it always from a high building under a certain level? And again, that has an influence on the protection concept in the roof. So you can reduce the thickness of your armor plate in the roof when you reduce the elevation angle. The same a bit for the windscreen for the higher levels. So also there, you are allowed to shoot it at the, what we call the built-in angle, so with the horizontal shot line for the higher threat levels. Also here again, it's a choice. It has to be specified in the requirements. So the areas to be tested, you see the full-scale vehicle. So the trick is that you test the weak spots of the vehicle. Nevertheless, we also shoot at some main areas, like on the door section, the glass, according, more or less to the PM standard. And then we aim at all kinds of areas, the door gaps. It's listed over there. In the PAS standard, it's really specified, those locations, and the number of shots for each of the location. In the VPM, the test institutes make the choices, but nevertheless, those areas need to be tested. Always with three shots in a kind of pattern. It could be the triangle on the larger surfaces, in the big triangle or the small triangle, or it could be in large line, what we say, for example, the edge of the door, you see three shots in a line with a certain distance, or for smaller parts, like the door lock or the mirror, for example, we do it in small lines. And we have to realize that each shot that we are putting on the vehicle is done under worst case condition. So we're really looking at the angle, the shooting angle, where you expect a penetration inside your vehicle. And at the other angle, you know that it has less performance. So each shot is done under worst case conditions. All shots have to be stopped. And in case of a perforation, you have to improve the protection concept, and it has to be retested. And sometimes it can be done on the spot, when it's quite obvious why the bullet penetrated the vehicle, and you add a simple solution, and then you can retest it again, and then it's solved. And of course, that modification is then part of the complete protection concept. And at the end of the process, we have to report all the results, and when it's all successful, we come to the certification document. That was for the ballistic part. Then we go to the blast part. It's a separate standard within the VPM. Also there, it's good to start with a test plan, and it's important to start with a test plan because you really have to specify the threats to be used in testing your vehicle. And that also counts for the location of the charges and the whole measurement setup. Then, of course, when you're not sure about your protection concept, stopping the fragments from a hand grenade or an AP mine, you can start with sample testing, like we are doing with the PM testing, but it's an option. But of course, you can always do that as a kind of industry test to first check your protection concept against those threats before building it into a vehicle. And then it comes to the ERV testing, where we take the complete vehicle. Again, we do the vehicle inspection, in general combined with the inspection for the BRV. We test the complete vehicle, like here, a side blast setup against this vehicle. And also there, you have the option that afterwards, when there's a problem or when you have a redesign, you can do kind of retest on a mock-up. I think for the side blast, it's not that obvious, but for example, for a hand grenade, putting it on a roof section, like I show you for the ballistic testing, it's still feasible to do that with a mock-up setup. So in the BRV, it's quite clear. You specify the level, and then you know the threat that need to be used for testing. In the ERV, you have several options, and that has to be specified in the requirements. So it's about, which type of hand grenade do you use just a single hand grenade, or do you use it in what we call the double modus? You have two hand grenades taped together. Is it only under the floor or also at the roof? And for the AP mine, we have the DM31, which is coming as specification from the Stanag standard. Then for the roadside blast protection, it's well specified within the VPEM. It's a bare explosive charge. And we place it in line with the B-pillar, because in general we know that that area is the weakest part. And then weakest parts in terms of the risk of affecting the occupant inside the vehicle, like the driver or co-driver sitting with his shoulder really close to the B-pillar. Sometimes I see the specification of the Stanag and a mix-up of those specifications. Well, I have to say that the blast charge specified in the VPEM differs from the charge specified in the Stanag. We have a cubic form on the right side, the VPEM standard, and we have a spherical charge on the left side in the Stanag standard. So we need to realize that it differs. And it also differs from the past 300 specification, for example. Now, the main question, of course, is what does it mean for the vehicle and the protection of the vehicle? Well, and that's quite a difficult answer to give, because it really depends on, distance, depends, on the ratio between peak pressure and impulse value. It depends on your protection concept. So there's not a one-to-one translation from one charge type to the other one. Of course, you can say probably they are close. So when we talk about the VPEM charge, it might be close to what we say, the 15 kg Stanag charge. But for testing, it's not the same. So we really have to be aware of that. So also here, we test under the worst case conditions. So when it comes to the hand grenades or the AP mine, in general, it's on top of the roof above the heads of the occupants. Or under the floor, under the feet of the occupants. Nevertheless, it can be needed to do an extra test where you have a different potential concept in the floor section, maybe in the rear or in the roof section, which might be weaker than in the other areas being tested, but could result into, for example, fragmenting effects. So in that case, you do an extra test to check that location of the vehicle as well, because again, it can affect the occupants inside your vehicle. Then in terms of the measurements, we analyze the fragmenting effects. We use witness plates or witness fall. We check if the roof does not hit the head of the occupant when a hand grenade is detonating on top of the roof. We use the VPEM contact sensor, or in English the roof head impact sensor. We measure the floor deformation. And then, and I promote that, you also want to measure the occupant response by using a mannequin inside the vehicle, because that gives you the direct link to the occupant safety. So here you see some pictures, and I also included two movies. This is a hand grenade test inside. You see and hear the explosion. You see a bit shaking of the vehicle. There is some damage outside the vehicle, but it's important to check what's happening inside. And then you see with a hand grenade on top of the roof, maybe you missed it, I can repeat it again. You see the cross above the head of the mannequin, and there you see with an high-speed cam the indent of the armor plate in the roof. It stays intact, there are no fragmentation effects, no rupture of the armor plate, and is in this case quite a big distance to the head of the mannequin. So also there it's safe. Then for the roadside blast, also there we test at the worst case location. So in general, that's aligned with the B-pillar section. Therefore, in general, we measure with a mannequin at the front row seat of the vehicle. And also here, we look into the fragmenting effects by using witness fall or by using video cameras, normal speed, high speed cams. We measure the pressure, and also there we want to focus to the occupant response, so therefore we make use of the mannequin according to the Stanag specifications. So this is the setup according to the VPM, where in the VPM it was written, hey, you can choose for the 2 or the 4 meter. Nevertheless, in your specification, you can also write down 3 meter, for example, but it needs to be specified and it needs to be written down in the test plan and the test report and, of course, in the certificate. But in general, 2 or 4 meters distance. Also here, 2 examples, a vehicle being tested. You see the high-speed cam, you see the explosion, and then you see how that affects the vehicle, which means, in general, the weaker parts, the plastic parts, are being affected and being dropped from the vehicle. But at the end, it's all about the response of the whole structure and the crew compartment. So therefore, we look at the inside. And with a slow motion cam, you see the response inside the vehicle. I can repeat it again. Explosion from the left in this case. So you see the flash. You see all components are shaking. The lid of the middle console is opening. And you see a bit shaking of the mannequin. But when I look at this picture and see limited motion of the occupant, then I already know, well, it is probably safe. So it was not impacted by the B-pillar against the shoulder. So in this case, also a successful result. Now then, back to the VPM, ERV. As mentioned, at the website is given, we have the edition 2, the VPM ERV 2010 edition 2, and we have the new one, the VPM ERV edition 3. So at the left side, the edition 2, where we do an analysis of the fragmenting effects, the floor deformation, the risk of head impact, we measure the pressure, and then it's written in the standard, it's an option to include a mannequin. And when it's being included, you use an anthropomorphic test device or crash test dummy, you need to specify the criteria. And then we say, as TNO, please copy then the standard from the STANAC and include the whole test procedures for measuring with the mannequin inside your vehicle. Also because that gives you a clear pass-fail approach. So it's really given when it's a fail, when it's a pass. And the ATD can be used for many times, as long as it's still valid within its calibration and certification setup. On the other side, we have the edition 3. You do the same analysis in terms of fragmenting effects, the roof head impact with the VPM contact sensor. We measure the pressure. And then when it comes to the occupant response, there the Biofidel Primus was introduced as a tool to measure the occupant response. And next to that, also the star ranking approach was introduced. Well, last year, that already gave a lot of discussions in this audience. I'm glad to see that tomorrow we have a speech from Mr. Schimmelpfennig from CTS, the developer of the Biofidel. Let's wait for tomorrow to get all the ins and outs on the Biofidel mannequin, and you can ask him about the pros and cons. For now, I will zoom into the mannequin itself, because it's a test device, it's a mechanical device, which gives you the possibility to measure the accelerations, the forces and moments in several body parts, and the deflection, so the compression for the chest, for example. And such a device should be repeatable, it should be reproducible, and it should be robust, so that you can use it many times. And then the most important part is that you need to have a link between the mechanical device to real injuries. Well, that's the most important part, but it's also the most difficult part and the most time-consuming part to get that link. And therefore, in the automotive industry, for car crash testing, that's already an existing expertise for more than 40 years. So it's not that you do that within 1 year and you have a new standard. So it's a real process to come up. So when you talk about the injury risk, then you have 2 parameters. It's the severity, given in the table above, which is a medical scoring system for a medical person to see or look at the injuries. Well, is it just minor injury, or is it really a severe, serious, or even critical injury? And next to that, because we are human beings with different anthropometry, different sizes, different gender, we have to introduce the risk curve. So you see here a risk curve, an example, where you see dots on the zero line, which means no injury. You see dots on the upper line at one, which means injuries. And then you can draw this risk curve. So to combine the mechanical mannequin, the crash dummy, with real injuries, you need to come up with a test setup, which are we calling match pair testing, that you really check the response of your mannequin with the response of a human, in order to see, okay, at which level do we see a certain severity of injury, and at which level not. And that's quite intensive to do. And there it starts also, well, what do we accept? What is acceptable? And that was a question raised within the STANAG team of experts, has given a lot of discussions. What do we really accept in theater, in a military operations? And then it was decided at the end, okay, we accept a maximum of moderate injury. Well, what does it mean? For example, for your lower leg, it's a simple leg fracture, simple tibia fracture. Of course, you need to go to the hospital for some medical care, but it's not really serious, not life-threatening, maybe not that affecting your the rest of your career. Hopefully you can come back and do your job again. But next to that, they say, okay, the chance, the risk, the likelihood should be very low. Just 10% probability to get that injury, which is quite a tough criterion. Well, that was the decision from the STANAG team of experts. And then they asked a separate working group of several working groups within the NATO, STO, Human Factors and Medicine panel to define the test method, to define the criteria, and to define the tolerance levels based on this requirement. Well, I'm proud to say that I was chairman of three successive working groups within the HFM. And together in an international setting with several countries over the world, we were able in several years, and then I'm talking at the end into 12 years or even 16 years, and there's a new group coming again, and we were able to define the test procedures. So for the vertical impact, we have the hybrid-free crash test dummy, and for the side impact, the Eurosit crash test dummy, and we specified those tables with several body regions. Probably the values are a bit difficult to read, but there you see the different body regions, the different criteria, the tolerance levels, and the values being measured in a test. And when you see it's over the limit, then it's not green, but it's red. Now, the advantage of using the crash test dummy, you get clear measurement data, and directly after the test, you know the answer. So you exactly also know what is the performance of my protection system, not only passing or failing, but how close are you to the limit, or how close are you just over the limit, or is there still a big margin, which of course is nice to have. On the other hand, you can say, okay, maybe my vehicle's too heavy and I can come up with a lighter concept. That's an option. And important, it's worldwide accepted, both in the automotive industry to make use of the mannequin, as well as in the military domain, thanks to the STANAG activities. So the question is, in the past they were developed for crash testing, where it's important to mimic the kind of kinematic response of the occupant, because you are driving, you're hitting a car or an object, and your body is moving forward. So that means the kinematic response should be more or less similar with your mannequin as with the real human being. And then you face the problems, inertial effects, the inertial effects between the difference between head and upper body response resulting in neck forces, or your impact against, the windscreen or the steering wheel, whatever. We are using now the crash dummy in our field, and there we see a different loading mechanism. We are talking about really high rate accelerations, much more faster than a crash test. And even when we see the vehicles now with all the crash zones, the peaks are lower, the duration is longer, in our field, especially with the blast effects, it's really high acceleration based in really short durations. So that also means that when you look at the response of your structure, you look into those areas which are being affected by the blast in the floor section, in the side section, the B-pillar section, responding to that force and resulting in impact loads to the occupants, for the lower leg, for the lumbar spine sitting on the seat system, and then on top of the roof for the head or risk of head impact, and the same for the side dummy. So we deal with really short local impact phenomena. As HFM, we realize that, so we need to have specific selected and developed criteria, as written here on the slide. So it was not just copying the mannequin from the automotive sector, the criteria from the automotive sector, and we have the solution. No, we really digged into the background info on the criteria, and we tried to select the best one, but we also tried to improve them or build up new ones. So this is a nice example. Here you see really on the top a real lower leg specimen, post-mortem human subject, PMHS, being instrumented and being tested for high rate loads. And the same was done with a mechanical model, the new developed lower leg model for the mannequin, the Millalix, with the same setup. And then in this way, you are able to derive such a risk curve. So that work was done within that international community, supported by the HFM, and after satisfying results, that was included in the test procedure. The same was done for the shoulder impact, which is also a critical area. The French took the lead and developed the criteria for that, for the really short, high rate impacts. So be aware, it was not just copying from the automotive sector, from crash testing. We really had our talks and thoughts about, what do we need? What is the best option? And it's not finished. It's a continuous process. So what I said, there will a new group started by the end of this year or next year in order to, look again into those criteria and hopefully with the option to improve them or to come up with new solutions. So that was what I want to share with you about, measuring with the mannequin. Again, tomorrow we will hear about using the Bifidel, and then we will see what it does mean for testing a vehicle. Then one of the last slides about report and certification. Of course, we finished the test campaign with a detailed report, and when it's all successful, then we can come up with a certification document. And it's all about proof and traceability. And so we write down what really happened in the test campaign, so also the failures and then the improvements. And we really write down, what do we have tested? Which type of vehicle? What is the reference to the design package, et cetera? And therefore, it's also important as an end user or a procurement officer that you not only ask for the one-page certificate, please also ask for the complete test report, because then you know the ins and outs and maybe also even the test plan, how was this vehicle being tested. And that also means that, I don't really like a one-page certificate. We always add some tables next to it, and I know IABG is also doing that, where you have the main figures, which vehicle is being tested, which concept, what are the main armor materials being used, how was it tested, when tested, et cetera, et cetera. Of course, some nice pictures with all the shots that at the end you can really see what was done with this vehicle, how was it tested. And also important, and then I come back to production quality control, when I see vehicle number 20, is the potential concept built in that serial vehicle number 20 still similar or at least representative for the test vehicle being tested, meaning that the question is the certificate still valid for that vehicle. And that brings me to the end of my presentation, kind of summary and, kind of teaser. So in the procurement of armored vehicles, it's really important to start with clear requirements on both the operational and functional level and then dig into the technical levels. And to really guarantee the occupant safety, you do need to have the vehicle standards in place and being applied for testing and certification. And of course, there are some differences between those standards, between the PAS, between the VEEP, and between the STANAG. Nevertheless, I think they all give a certain confidence in the safety of the vehicle. The vehicle is being tested. Maybe the specs are a bit different, but nevertheless, it was tested according to that standard. So you can refer to the VPM and maybe say, okay, we also accept the STANAG. Or you say, okay, we accept both VPM and STANAG standard. It's all possible, to my opinion. Again, focus is to the occupant safety. So therefore, I think it's important that you also focus to the occupant response when doing a test campaign. So as TNO, we recommend to introduce or to make use of the ATD. And well, I show you the backgrounds of the ATD. And then by saying that, and by knowing the world is changing, the type of cars are changing, electric vehicles are popping up. And this is a picture from 2 weeks ago, or 3 weeks ago now. It was on the 7th of October in Israel. And this guy with his Tesla Model 3 was attacked. Of course, it was not protected, that vehicle. He was lucky because he was able to drive for 20, 23 kilometers to the hospital, because he was injured, but well, the vehicle was still driving. The guy was more or less okay, and he also wrote that, well, it was also thanks to the dual engine, because you see the front tires are gone, so they were shotted as well, but he was able to reach the hospital. Well, he was lucky, I think, because when you think about shooting at the battery, creating a shortcut, well, what's happening then? A mobility kill or even fire? So what are the risks when having a kind of battery or the complete floor filled up with batteries? When it comes to the risk for the occupants, what's then accepted? How to protect? And then important also how to test. You see we are testing indoor. When you shoot at the battery indoor and it starts burning, well, you can think about the consequences for the building, but also for the people doing the tests. So that are really important questions, and I know they are popping up now, because over a couple of years, you can't buy a vehicle anymore without a battery. So the minimum is a mild hybrid car with a 48 voltage battery somewhere in the vehicle. And in the past, it was in the back. Now I see it's under the floor or under the seats of the occupants. So. But on the other hand, next to a risk, maybe it could also help to protect, because you have a heavy battery package in your floor, so it helps to protect maybe against the fragments and the blast. We don't know, so therefore we need to do some research. And that brings me to the end of my presentation, and I would like to thank you very much for your attendance, and well, I'm here today and tomorrow for answering your questions.
All right, thank you very much. Thank you so much. It was a most interesting and informative and critical part of the program along the way. And I've got actually two parts of the same question. So one of the issues that come about when looking at vehicle 100 or 20 and vehicle 0, when it comes to vehicle 0, so two parts. One is, do you weigh the vehicle? And if you do, are there parameters around that? Because that's one easy way to verify to a degree that vehicle 20 is the same as vehicle 0. The second part is, and was raised, I think Fadi raised it yesterday, what of the internal trimmings of the vehicle is included in vehicle 0 for the testing? And then what happens if you then add, for example, a radio system or a camera system into the vehicle after vehicle 0? How then do you correlate that reconfiguration to the vehicle 0 certification?
Good questions. When it comes to the weight of the vehicle, we all say the vehicle and the vehicle protection, it's really the responsibility of the supplier. And so we leave that to them. Please specify that in detail. So also the weight. Sometimes we do a check on the weight. But to really say, okay, you have to specify the weight of vehicle 0. And well, at the end, you hope that vehicle 20 or 25 has more or less the same weight. And of course, we shouldn't care about a small difference in terms of the weight. It's just a kind of check. When it comes to the trim of the vehicle, there you see some difference. You saw a picture with a quite naked vehicle inside, so you saw really the steel construction. You can say, okay, that's more or less the worst case condition, because you know that the trim does help to stop fragments, or at least the splash of a bullet. On the other hand, when you have a certain trim inside, like the roof ceiling with some stiff parts, when it's not there when you are testing, then in reality, you can accelerate the roof and hitting the occupant. So that's then the danger. So that means in your test plan specification, you should, and that's then the expertise, and you should really discuss, well, what type of trim is really important to integrate in your test vehicle, vehicle number zero, and which are less relevant, and you can skip that. So that's the kind of, well, talking together, discussing together, in order to define the complete setup of a vehicle. And of course, we have those discussions, and also when it comes to, well, can we add a hatch, can we add a gun ports? Yes, of course you can, but it has maybe a consequence. It could be a negative or a positive consequence. But when you don't include it and you want to sell your vehicle with a gun port or a hatch, yeah, then you know that the certificate is not valid. So that is the reason for saying it's not just testing, get the vehicle, shoot at it. Nee, it's a process, and it starts with the requirements. It starts with have the talks together, how to test, what's really needed. The meaning, you have to define a test plan. And when you have a test plan, then you can continue with the whole process.
Yes, okay. Alex, go for it.
Thank you very much for the great presentation. Very interesting. Two very simple questions. The more difficult ones I ask directly. Is there a new secretariat for WIPAM? First question. And the second one, you mentioned that the WIPAM is available also for the non-member WIPAM test institutes, and they can be accredited. So some advice for me, because my other UN entities asked me when they sent their certificates, and let's make a hypothetical case, I have a Chinese test center accredited by the Chinese National Accreditation Organization, and they test according to WIPAM centers. How can I find out, or how should I handle this to be legally safe? Thank you.
Yeah, good questions. When it comes to the secretary, at the moment, Tino is both the chairman, or has the chairmanship and the secretary role. We have some talks, and well, Tim Renes can maybe give some answers in detail later on, to split it or to find another volunteer or member to take over that role. But at the moment, it's Tino. So when you have a question, you have to reach Tino, and well, on the VPAM website, you can find the link, the contact details. Then the second question, just remind you, the Chinese, the accreditation. Well, that's in fact one of the goals of the VPAM, that you have a group of test institutes that speak with each other to share experience and to do the same job in the same way. I think, well, it should be open also for other parties, but that, well, takes time. And again, also here, when you get a report from a Chinese institute being Chinese accredited, please ask for the test report, because in the test report you have all the details. And of course, then you can argue the fact, well, was the speed of the projectile, the velocity of the projectile correctly measured? Okay, then you have to go there and see how they are doing that. So do you check on your own how they do the whole process. And of course, it's not that easy, but I think on the other hand, just having an accredited lab is also not a guarantee. Because I think, and I think my colleagues can support me, it's all about the expertise. Hey, you need to have experience how to test. You need to learn from all the effects that could happen. And even nowadays, well, I have quite a long time done all kinds of tests, but each test you learn again. So it's about, well, learning and sharing and, well, developing.
Yeah, Thank you. I have more than a comment than a question. So first of all, Pidjan, thank you for the presentation. Excellent as always. So I think you mentioned you cannot create something within 1 year where groups of experts took decades for. But actually, when we look at the edition 3, basically that happened. I think it's with VPAM, and we all know in this community the issues which arrived from the edition 3, and I think the intransparency and creating a closed circle where even TNO has no access to edition 3 is a way in the wrong direction. And we see more and more tendencies from organizations turning away from the VPAM because they don't accept these intransparencies. And that's my wish, and I trust for TNO as taking over the chairmanship of the VPAM to guide the VPAM in the right direction again in the future. And I think a good standard is open and it's transparent for all the people involved, because in the end you want to get better products, and yeah, then this is essential, because otherwise you will not get what you want.
I fully agree. Transparency is really essential for those standards.
Hi, I'm Nick from Mahindra. We tested the Toyota Land Cruiser to the Edition 3. At the time, there was only one agency that would actually do that testing, and I say, how can that possibly be a standard if nobody else actually is able to look at that standard in detail? It's just a guideline, and VPAM is a guideline, really, not a standard. And then you look at, I think the end users are misled by VPAM, unintentionally, but for the TLC 200, for example, there were 129 variants. Some of that included alterations to the body, but we wouldn't have tested all 129 variants. So when the UN put a tender out and say, yep, we want your VPAM VR7 vehicle, by the end of the life cycle of the TLC 200, it was never going to be what was tested. So it really is misleading people. Misleading end users, I think, and it needs to be a lot more flexible. And I think they should be looking at the company being certified rather than just the vehicle, because a lot of clients might not use the TLC 300. They might want a TLC 78 or a vehicle that isn't produced much. There's no way that the armoring company can afford to spend $500,000 testing a vehicle they're going to sell 10 units of. So there's a lot of B6 vehicles purchased, and you can tell the end user, oh yeah, but B6 is only a material specification, but that's not how they understand it. They understand it as a threat level, and they say, I want you to build me a vehicle that will defend against these threat levels. Okay, we're not going to test it, we're going to build it. There needs a verification process of that build, and that's where VPAM and the testing agencies should be looking to improve their service to say, okay, we appreciate you, you're not going to test a GMC Savannah because you only sell 10 of them. What you should do is send in your designs. Our experts will look over them and give them our opinion and certify it to a certain level. Because there's been a lot of deaths in places like Somalia where people have got in B6 vehicles that they thought were safe, but they weren't. No floor protection whatsoever. Because there's no accountability on the actual design, and there's no accountability on the VPAM design, really, because the end user does not understand it and will never understand it.
I fully agree with your statement, and also I'm aware of the complexity. So therefore, it's also good to know that it's possible to do mock-up testing. So when you already have a certified vehicle and you have small changes, you can come up with what I showed you, the rear end of a vehicle. So that makes it a bit cheaper. The other option, what we also always offer, start with the experts to look into the design, and we call that then a design review. Because with our expertise, and we have a ballistic expert, and I'm more on the blast side, we can have a critical look at your concept together, go through your CAD model, and you can already see, where are the strong and the weak parts in your protection concept. And then you can, come up with an improvement before you go with your complete vehicle to our institute and start shooting Because we have seen it once that we start shooting and the first shot was already a perforation on your main armor concept. Yeah, that then it stops. So also there, you need to be keen about the whole process. Where are the risks? Can we mitigate those risks by doing a kind of design review with the experts before going into the whole process? It's not the complete answer for you, I realize, but at least that are, well, the ways I think we have to go forward with. That's a good point. Left hand and right hand drive. Also, there we get the questions. You really have to check what are the difference then, and then you see the difference in your firewall build-up, and then you have to check if the certificate for the left hand vehicle is still applicable for the right hand vehicle, or do we need to have to do some extra measures with an extra protection plate, and that you can test it well separately or in a mock-up, or and maybe we come that far, you can prove that by simulation. At the end, it's all about, again, acceptance, and acceptance by the end user. Do we accept those verification steps to see if that new design, is more or less comparable to the certified design with all those steps in between. But I think it's possible.
Hi, yeah, so Ian from Create. Great presentation, thank you very much. But just one question about airbags. On the video that we saw, we didn't see any airbag deployment during the blast. Now, it may be that the blast pulse is just too quick or something like that, so the airbags don't deploy. But do you test with airbags fitted? If so, do they deploy? And if they do deploy, how does that affect your biofidelic measurements from the actual test itself?
Because of, the safety for the test personnel, we say, please remove the airbag. Once we did a test, I have to say it was with a truck where the airbag was there and fully active. And we noticed there was no response of the airbag because it's really a different threat. Deploying an airbag really requires a specific acceleration loading profile. And with a blast effect, it's quite far away from that specification. So in general, I don't expect a deployment of the airbag in the blast phenomenon. But nevertheless, for the safety of testing, we asked to remove the airbag.
All right, I'm just going to take one last question, and then we'll break for lunch, and I'll just give you a few messages before that.
Hi, Justin Brooks from Control Risks. And this may be a question that we leave till tomorrow to the dummy presentation. The fact that we carry a number of clients all have a different risk appetite for the wearing of body armour. I get continually asked all the time, is there any adverse effect of wearing body armour inside the vehicles? My question is really, is there any data? Has there been any testing done with the dummy? I notice on the pictures there is no body armour being worn. Yeah. With body armour being worn and perhaps the increased mass on the upper body, the effect that would have on the dummy in a blast scenario.
There is data. In general, we say, we prefer testing without body armour because it can influence the response of your mannequin and also influence the measurements, especially for the side impact dummy. It's not allowed to wear a body armor vest because it really influenced the for example, the rib intrusion. So that's also specified in the STANAC standard. In our research and also together with the Germans, IABG, we know there is an influence and that could be positive, it could be negative. When it comes to the inertia effects, it's a bit negative because you have extra mass. When it comes to risk of head impact, maybe then it's a positive effect. Dus it's hard to say what are the pros and cons of wearing the helmet or the vest. What we do see when testing, especially in the military domain with helmets and vests, we see a quite different sitting posture. You're really being pushed forwards in your seat. That also means you get a different load transfer into the mannequin. And that can give you a different answer than testing with the naked mannequin. What is then the answer? Also there, I think it's more operational driven. Is there a need for wearing a helmet and a vest during your mission? And if that's more or less the standard, maybe then there's a need also to include that in the test procedure. Or do we say, you really check the performance of your protection concept in terms of floor response, seat response, and, well, the integrity of your whole structure, and you can check that with the naked dummy, knowing that there might be some influence of an armor system, an armor vest or a helmet, but at least the aim at the end is to check the performance of your protection concept. So then I think it's still good to go ahead with the naked mannequin, knowing that, of course, there is an influence of body armor.
Okay, thank you very much. Much appreciated. Again, this is a topic that is endless in the questions and the configurations, as Nick pointed out. There are so many different configurations to this. And the great challenge for industry is from the specification development with a procurement agency to understand these issues, speaking and liaising with industry who then testing these issues at the beginning rather than the end of the process, incorporating within the technical specifications, and then the ability to assess the technical responses so that there is a true apples for apples comparison between different technical responses. And this is the great challenge that industry faces, and not something we'll resolve in the next 2 days, but as ongoingly we shall. So thank you very much again.